So this week I thought it would be fun to do a start to finish edit inside of Lightroom Classic. So why don't we just jump in right now? So what we're doing is combining HDR and panoramas. So what we're doing is we're shooting a 3-image HDR bracket, which is giving us the darker image gives us detail there in the sky. And you can see the lighter image starts to give us more detail on the ground. So there's 3 brackets there. Notice that line there is a cloud line in the sky. It's part of the original photo, so it's not an artifact. So if you notice it later, that's in the original. All right, and then same thing here. Now we're panning the camera a little bit to the left. Same thing, the 3 brackets. So that gives us details for the highlights. This gives us details for the shadow area. And by the way, I use a drone for this, but works exactly the same on the camera. All right, super easy to merge this together. Just select all the images, Control A or Command A, right click, and then we're gonna use Photo Merge, and we're gonna choose HDR Panorama. And notice this is giving us a preview of what we're gonna get. So this is gonna merge these images together. Notice we get the shape around the edge. This is very typical for a panorama. Now we have options. We could choose fill edges and synthesize those edges, and it will just kind of fill up that area. The other option is we can use auto crop, and in auto crop, all that is doing is it's just finding all the transparent areas and cropping them out. And this also works. And if you look at this, sometimes it's a good option. Just make sure you're not losing anything important in that image. And then the other option is boundary warp. If we take boundary warp and we drag this out, it's like printing on a piece of gum or silly putty and then just stretching it out. Now, this is good if you want to preserve every pixel in your image. The downside of this, notice that it starts to curve a lot at the edges because it's warping the image. Take it back here. It's still a little bit of warping, but not as bad. Of course, we can go into Photoshop and we can also fix that. All right, so why don't we do what I like to do as a combination. I like to hit the auto crop and then take the boundary warp and just drag it a little bit so we're recovering. Because see this tree on the left? If we go here, it's just being lost. We can save that tree and just kind of frame it nicely there. Same thing on the right, we start to get a little bit more detail. That works pretty good. There's another setting here, auto settings. What that would do is it's just going to preliminary just move the sliders for us. So it's just an auto. And in fact, the auto crop and the auto settings are completely non-destructive. The only destructive movement here is boundary warp. You can't change this after everything else you can. So be careful if you decide to use that, make that decision at this stage. And then we're just going to hit merge. And what it's going to do is it's going to take those 6 images and it's going to merge them together into a brand new file. And here it is. And this is going to be a DNG file. So let me double click to open it up here so we can see it. And if we go to the develop module, you'll notice if we go to the crop tool, there's that auto crop was set. And you could undo this later. You could expand it if you needed more of this. And then I would probably take it into Photoshop and use generative fill. The remove tool doesn't do a good job of filling up transparent areas. In fact, it won't do that. All right, so why don't we go back here and we're gonna go back to the adjustments and now we want to adjust this. So the first thing I'm seeing is look at that sky. It's looking pretty good. It's a little bit bright. We want more detail. This is definitely too dark in this part of the image. Very, very typical when you're shooting into a sunset. All right, so why don't we take the exposure and we just can bring it up a little bit. Now we're starting to see some detail and it's looking pretty good in the foreground. Background is losing all of its detail. Highlight, we recover them, drag it all the way to the left. Notice now we can recover it. This is the beauty of working in HDR, is that we have all this information that we can recover in those areas. And we're not making the photo look artificial, we're just reproducing what we saw when we were there. Let's do the same thing in the shadows, open that up a little bit. And now I can afford to take the exposure, maybe drop it a little to the left. Notice I go pretty heavy on the highlights, but more subtle on the shadows. This gives a much more realistic kind of appearance to the image. Now, if we want to pop this image a little bit, I'm going to take the texture and push it up a little bit. So what texture does is it shows a little bit more detail in things like this tile roof. If we turn that off, turn up the texture. See how it shows that? But it's not putting halos around the images. I mean, if we go all the way, it will, but let's just go a little bit. And we're just giving it a little touch, just to kind of pop it. It's almost like a high, it's almost like a slightly lower frequency sharpening, meaning it's sharpening larger areas of details than you would get with the sharpen. So if we go into detail here, we can hit the sharpen, which will sharpen the finer details. Be careful of that because it can introduce noise if you get too heavy. All right, great. So the next step is to give it some punch and give it some life. Often I'll take it into Photoshop and do dodging and burning, but why don't we do it here inside of Lightroom today? So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to just close that out. So it just gives me a little bit more space to work with. And then we're going to go under the mask. And under the mask, I'm going to grab a brush. Now, I'm not going to do any auto masking with this. I'm going to simply take the brush. I'm going to keep the density quite high, but I'm going to take it to about 75. So that means it's not going to go any brighter than 75. Then I'm going to take that flow down a little bit to around about 15 so I can build that up over time. Feather's good. The size. Now, you don't want to adjust the size here because you can't see it on the image. You know, you can see it like right there, but you can't see it where you want it. If you go here and you hit the left bracket key, you can make it smaller, right bracket key, you can make it bigger, but you can see exactly where you're going with it. So I'm going to hit the left bracket key, and I want to do a little bit of light maybe coming in here and hitting some of this image. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to start to paint. Why don't I just kind of start to paint here? And what it's doing right now is it's just adding a mask. And we're probably not going to be using that mask exactly as it is. But we're going to go here, and now we're going to make the adjustments. So if we go to the brightness, notice we can increase that brightness a little bit. So we can take the exposure up a little bit, and I'm also going to take the shadows up a little bit. All right, so we can use this now if we want to add brighter parts of the image. One of the areas I'd love to do it is along the waterline. So let's just follow along here, and we're just going to paint along here. By the way, I'm using a Wacom tablet for this. You can do it with a mouse if you don't have one. And I'm just going to just quickly just go around here. And this is something that you might not even notice. Like when I'm really working on this for real, you won't see much difference until I show you a before and after. So I'm getting a little bit more heavy-handed than I might sometimes. And I'm just going to give a bit more light over here, up this area. All right, so you might not see much going on here, but if I was to take this mask and we turn it off and on, notice how we've subtly lit up some of that area. All right, so I want to do the same thing. I want to create a new brush. I'm going to create a new mask. I'm going to grab the brush. And this time, I'm going to take the exposure down on the mask. So if I take the exposure, you can see nothing's really going to happen till I start painting. So let's start painting here at the front of the house, because these areas would be in shadow. Notice now I could change that exposure, could make it very dark, but we're not going to get too carried away. I'm going to take the highlights down a little bit here. All right. And now we can paint these maybe right here above the waterline on the bank. And I'm just adding a little shadow. Little shadow along here. So if we turn this mask off, we can see before and after. Okay, now we're going to just hit these adjustments to go to the overall adjustment. Let's go back to the basics. And this is a point, at this point now, I'll start to look at contrast. Do I want to reduce the contrast or do I want to increase it a little bit? I'm going to let the contrast pop just a little bit. Maybe hit that exposure just a smidge. And let's take the temperature and just slightly warm it up. Notice how I'm doing all of this at the end. And I think we've got a pretty good result right there. And see the we've got a little bit of warping there. We could actually fix that by bringing it into Photoshop. So thanks for watching. I hope you found that useful. Let me know in the comments underneath. And if you're new, welcome to the cafe. Hit that subscribe button, turn on notifications, and you won't miss any of my videos. And until next time, I'll see you at the cafe.